Hi there. Somebody asked whether the Fed printing money would get it out of trouble, and the answer is very short. It's no. Of course not. In my opinion, if you ask me, why doesn't it work? Simply because the economical problems is not about the amount of money that's available. That's not the issue here. The issue is that energy resources are dwindling, shifting, moving about, and that there's no productive capacity in the US. True productive capacity. But primarily it's the energy. That's primarily the biggest problem. So if you print more dollars, it's fine. But you don't have enough energy to produce whatever you have to produce. Because if there was enough energy, just a very simple question, you know, if there was enough energy to do everything, to drive every machine around the world, would there be an economical crisis? Answer is, of course, no. Why would there be an economical crisis? Why would somebody bother with all kinds of trouble in economics? You know? Ridiculous. You know, you can make everything you want. So if we had an infinite energy source, then everything would be fine. We would not have an economical crisis. That's why it's very clear that the economical crisis is caused by energy shortages, resource shortages, dwindling resources. And of course, the whole idea of economics that that resources are, let's say, externality, and that they are infinite, of course, is a testament to its insanity. But I never believed in economics, even in high school when I was listening to the guy. I had to conclude after a while that I really didn't know made no sense to me. I always fell asleep. And to me, the definition I arrived at of economics is that it's maximizing the utility of fossil fuels. So if you have an amount of fossil fuels, you want to use it, but then you want to use it as wise as possible, as most productive as possible. And to do that, you have economists that talk about it in a way that makes people do that, and bankers that invest in productivity that is more productive, more efficient with the carbon fuel, but at the same time uses everything that's there. And the world economy simply has had an evolution which was only, let's say, slowed down by interdependencies between fossil fuel deliverer, person, somebody that uses that fossil fuel, so somebody that has an internal combustion engine, or a stove, oil stove, and then the amount of people. So you basically had a process where fossil fuel was made available, and then somebody invented the internal combustion engine, and somebody invented the diesel engine, and then cars were made, and people bought those cars, and they made tractors, and so there was more food, so the more people came around, and they could buy more cars, so more cars were built, and that made that the oil makers, the oil producers, had more reason to create more oil, or get more oil out of the ground, and that was dragging, let's say everybody was dragging each other along. Why? Well, because there was plenty of oil on the ground as long as you care to go and dig it up. And I believe, I'm quite certain, that there were decisions made that some people, some oil resources, simply would not be touched for now, because there was enough for everybody. And a theory I have is that it's basically more or less about how much oil everybody is allotted in on a continent and country by country. That's what's being determined basically, and then if you utilize it smart enough, then you are a more prestigious country. That's just like when you have a little street and everybody tries to make his house as beautiful as possible. That's the process that's really going on. But anyway, that's a side note. So printing more money won't help at all. What will help is moving your productive capacity, your productive side of your economy, to be fully powered by renewables. Why? Because the cost of renewables tends to zero. It becomes marginal labor that you have to perform, and maybe some welding and sewing and recasting and all that stuff. And of course, people doing that can be paid in the energy that you produce with those renewable energy sources. Renewable energies are generative, are basically producing energy. That's not a very big surprise, but they are generative in the same way as the economy used to be. Every economy around the world used to be generative. Even an Ethiopian farmer at the moment with a little plot of land, he's energy positive. He walks around in the sun, he does something with the ground. As a result of that, the ground starts using the solar energy that hits it, and the rain water that falls on it becomes productive. He produces biomass. He eats a little piece of the biomass. He gives some of it to others, which is, of course, energy surplus of stored solar energy that he's handing out and feeding his family with. Low-tech, that's what everybody used to do. And then you can have an advanced agricultural society or a slow, you know, as long as the plowing and the processing and all that stuff is done with animals and humans, or maybe a water mill or a windmill, it's absolutely energy positive. There's always more energy coming out of that whole system than, or it's basically storing solar energy. So that's also a way to say it. Now, as soon as you start carbonizing driving that whole process with carbon energy, you're going to you're moving into a dead end situation. And I've talked about that. It's the post-petro food gap, you could call it. It is what happens if areas get cut off from fossil fuel fertilizers. While they fully depend on it, their ground is dead, their soil is dead and unproductive without fertilizer. And they have to wait until the soil gets productive again. That Ethiopian farmer, if he buys fertilizer, then his land gets a little bit more productive. And he, of course, goes into debt for that, because nobody cares about what he makes. The only thing that is being cared about is, how much fertilizer can I sell to this motherfucker, so we can have the margins of that whole process of selling fertilizer to people. And then, you know, we also control the country, because now the country is fully dependent. The Ethiopian little plot of land is fully dependent on fertilizer. If I withdraw the fertilizer, the guy dies of famine. There's regular panics in Africa, in areas where it's not sure where the fertilizer will be delivered, as soon as these areas become dependent on fertilizer. It's a death trap, fossil fuels. And it's very, very stupid. Anyway, this is a little bit of a random video. But so my argument is all the time is to go for a renewable powered society. So you basically identify three energy sources. One is labor, manual physical labor by people or by animals. The second is fossil fuel, of course we know it. And the third is renewables. And you basically try to get rid of the fossil fuel out of your society. Try to use the renewables to the maximum possible, and of course create more and more renewable capacity, because solar panels, they don't just rust away, they go on for 50 years. And then try to automate processes, so you need as little unhealthy labor, back-breaking labor of people as possible. And it's amazing how you could really reorganize society. You know, if there's farmers listening to this, I'd like, use the ammonia in your tractors. If your cow shits your whole stable full of ammonia, or your pigs or whatever swine you have, and you create like mountains and rivers of ammonia, filter out the ammonia. It's perfect fuel for your tractor. In Holland, that I've proposed that a thousand times to farmers, and they always say, well, yeah, but it's a pollutant and we have to pay for it to be removed and all this stuff. And we ask to cover the little pond so it doesn't go into the atmosphere and all that stuff. They never realize that, of course, that's also an economy. People are making huge profits because they are handling these pollutants. And of course, they're making sure that the oil companies, the fertilizer sellers and all those people keep selling their fertilizer and keep selling their oil and keep selling whatever they need to be selling. But this is morality. If you take a very simple principle, and of course, you know, I really appreciate my audience. It's not very big, but I write about it in other places. And it's nice to basically repeat and basically practice my argument. But you simply have to say, well, the society has to be energy neutral. It has to be all clean, so nothing can be a pollutant. Why would you create a pollutant if you do not need to have a pollutant? And of course, The only reason why that is a problem is because productive capacity for renewable sources is usually driven with fossil fuels. So it's still dependent on fossil fuels. So you, as soon as you can, you should try to make sure that your factory of windmills and wave powered energy and solar panels is driven with renewables, because then you can basically create a loop of increased productivity based on renewables. You don't have to go to any bank or any fossil producer to ask for fossil fuel credit, carbon credit, and you're completely free to move into this to this clean robo economic society, where you can use machines to clean up the environment if you want, because they run on renewables. Actually, I'm working on a story about the steam man, but I'll work on it a little bit more, because it's really funny and it's actually quite possible science fiction concept. And if you heard about Petman, PETMEN of Boston Robotics, I believe, check it out on YouTube. It's quite possible to have androids walking around in areas that you really don't want to care to go, just making sure that everything grows there and everything is clean and healthy and the environment restores itself or creates itself in a more biological fashion. All running on renewables, of course. That's, I think, not science fiction. It is simply not done. And then not done in a way that you say, well, shouldn't be done. But simply people are still just too dumb to grasp the opportunity that's there to have a renewable future, which is also a little bit longer than the future that we have now, which thanks to Shell and Exxon is not going to be very, very happy or long. But thanks for listening. Once again, a random video, but I appreciate your audience.